Well, if it gets real quiet at some point this afternoon, you'll know the bees have made their way up here to the press box, and I'm getting out of here.
What's that buzzing? You hear a buzzing? There they are. That's a good shot of them right there. You can see the swarm of bees. That is right under the overhang here. And there's a lot of them. They were over by the Giant bullpen earlier, and now they're making their way out into the sunshine. And AJ will have to keep an eye on the bees and the balls out there in center field.
Yeah, we thought there might be a delay to the start of this game because as Tim Lincecum and pitching coach Dave Righetti went down to the bullpen in right field to warm up, that's when the bees first made their presence felt, and Lincecum got a very late start to his warm-ups.
Bronson Arroyo ready to make his Diamondbacks debut against Angel Pagan, who leads it off for the Giants. Finale of a four-game set here at Chase Field. Ball one, and we're underway. Your Arizona Ford starting pitcher is Bronson Arroyo. Last season, 14-12, 3.79, 32 starts with the Cincinnati Reds. And since 2005, no pitcher has started more games. Only two pitchers have thrown more innings. He, because of his dedicated conditioning and somewhat durable physiology, has taken the ball every fifth day for the last decade plus and has never been on the DL. His 15th season in the big leagues at the age of 37. Right to the bees. AJ Pollock backing up. He's got it on the track, and he is getting out of there in a hurry. Yep. Swatting the bees away as he catches the baseball. One out.
Now that's focus and concentration right there. He fully knew he was going to run right back into that swarm of bees, but never takes his eye off the ball.
I mean, are you kidding me? The first ball is hit right into the swarm.
Oh, boy.
Look at AJ out there. I was in Australia. I was playing in another hemisphere. I come back, I'm surrounded by bees. And we're only six games into the season. One away. Here's Gregor Blanco. Blanco getting the start in left field for the Giants. Eric Cooper is the second base umpire. He's having some fun out there with Aaron Hill.
Yeah, Aaron Hill said, if you hear him coming my way, please let me know.
And now we've got Pat Hoberg, the plate umpire, is looking into the dugout. Kirk Gibson, I think, is concerned about the bees. And now we'll have a discussion here. Chris Guccione, the third base umpire. You just saw him signal into Tom Hallion. Hallion is the crew chief. He's working first base this afternoon. And I think the bees are creating kind of a buzz here. Gibby's got a point. I mean, there's the umpire. You can't have your center fielder surrounded by bees trying to catch a fly ball in the bright sunshine.
And not wanting to play the position that you probably should be in because the bees
are there
first.
I see what you did there.
Yeah.
You walked right into it.
So here comes the crew chief Hallion, and we'll sort this out. Can you review bees?
I guess if you want to identify the bees and determine which exact kind of bees they are, but you know, this is not uncommon. This happens a lot more often than you might think. You know, half a dozen times a year you'll see a game either delayed or canceled because of bees on the field.
It happened at Tempe Diablo, I think, in an Angels game the last week of the Cactus League season, and there are a large swarm of bees right now in right center field. Kirk Gibson seems to have gotten his answer from the umpiring crew, and they'll resume their positions out there. Now they'll relay a message, the umpires, to the Diamondback outfielders, and here's what we come up with. Here we get AJ one of those beekeeper outfits.
Helmets with the screen in the front.
Send some guys out there with some smoke.
Let it be played over the PA system, and now.
Don't worry.
Be happy.
I see what you did there again. So Hallie and the crew chief taking charge of this situation.
He's saying, don't worry about it. We got the poison control center on speed dial. If anything happens, we'll get you out of here quickly.
everybody back to where we started here.
I mean, we're having a little fun with it, but there are people who are seriously, seriously averse to bee stings. Like Brad Steinke.
At the plate, left fielder number 7, Gregor Blanco.
And we're set to resume now with one out in the top of the first, right out there in right center field. The fans don't seem to mind.
They don't seem to mind at all.
Tom Hallion had relayed his explanation as to what was happening to the Giant dugout. He's resumed his spot over there as the first base umpire. And Blanco steps back into the box. Strike one.
And we should alert the fans watching at home that no, our radar gun is not on the fritz. You'll see readings from the low 60s to occasionally the low 90s on a good day. I mentioned it in the open of the show. He'll throw all of his pitches, variety of arm angles, variety of speeds. It's just not a comfortable at bat.
Right by Roberto Kelly.
That's another thing that you will get used to seeing from Bronson Arroyo. A lot of the hard hit balls against him go into foul territory. That slider off the plate inside right there to Gregor Blanco. The only place he could hit that ball was into foul territory.
Knocks that one into the ground. Easy play for Goldie to them. Giants lineup looks as such.
We've seen Pagan and Blanco, followed by Brandon Belt making his way to the plate right now. He's been a D-backs killer. Pablo Sandoval batting cleanup, followed by Hunter Pence. Hector Sanchez doing the catching for Buster Posey today. Brandon Crawford at shortstop. A. Ray Adrianza playing second base today. And the freak, Tim Lincecum, on the mound for the Giants.
You knocked that out of the park.
Well, fourth game of the series. About time.
Here's Brandon Belt. Strike one. Buzzing with confidence. We got all kinds of things happening at the ballpark today.
Man.
The King Neptune out there?
I think so.
In the pool. Sure. You'd be near the water. That makes sense. Poseidon. This certainly is a Poseidon adventure.
Goodness, what a start.
Yeah, what's next? Can't wait for the bottom of the first.
You know, we should point out about Bronson Arroyo that he will give up the occasional long ball. 32 homers pitching in that bandbox in Cincinnati last year. The good news is 21 of them were solo homers.
And he gave up 46 homers 3 years ago. And part of the reason for that is, as Bob mentioned, he's around the plate a lot. Doesn't walk anybody. He's allowed an average of less than 2 bases on balls per 9 innings in each of the last 2 years. And as soon as I say that, he goes full on Brandon Belt. There was some question as to whether Arroyo would even be able to make this start. Suffered that bulging disc in his back during spring training. That one is hit well to right field, headed for the corner, and that ball is in the bullpen and gone. Brandon Belt has done it again. His third home run in this series, and it's 1-0 Giants. Well, you said it, Bob. He is occasionally prone to the long ball.
Well, and you followed that up with the fact that part of that is because he throws strikes. He doesn't want to walk Brandon Belt and have Pablo Sandoval up there with two runners on base. He did throw a slider that just drifted over that inside part of the plate, and we've seen Brandon Belt absolutely kill pitches from the middle of the plate in this series.
Belt so far in the series is 6-for-14, 3 homers and 5 RBIs. Here is the Panda. Strike one to Pablo Sandoval. Brandon Belt has tortured the Diamondbacks here. Last season, he had 345 against the D-backs, had 11 RBIs in 16 games. And he's off to an even better start against the D-backs this year. Chris Owings, and they retire Sandoval. But Brandon Bell, his eighth home run versus the Diamondbacks since the start of the 2012 season.
Similar B episode. I had a chance to go down there. The game was delayed then, and had a chance to speak with a gentleman who was using a vacuum to clean up the bees. I asked him what his title. He said he was a beekeeper. And I said, well, the important part of being a beekeeper is actually keeping the bees. They were out there, and we're actually out here now near the batter's eye, and there's actually a beekeeper as well from Sexton Pest Control, and this is really kind of where they're starting to congregate. Guys, as you mentioned, I am allergic to bees, but...
Get out of there, Brad!
We're starting to congregate.
Save yourself!
On some of the pipes out here, but no delay as of right now, so hopefully we'll get this situation well in hand.
You know, the number, they found a bee guy. That was fast.
Very
bee wrangler.
24-7. They're right on the spot.
And they're hanging out there in right center field as Gerardo Parra looks at ball one from Tim Lincecum. Oh. There's a strike, and it's 1-1. There he is. Sexton Pest Control. Nice job. Got him right out here. Rolled the first, Bell takes it himself, one away. Here's the lineup that will attack. Hopefully swarm Tim Lincecum.
There you go. Gerardo Parra followed by Aaron Hill and Paul Goldschmidt at the top of the order. Martin Prado, Mark Trumbo, and Chris Owings back in the lineup at shortstop this afternoon. A.J. Pollock battling the bees out there in center field. Tuffy Gostowicz doing the catching today for right-hander Bronson Arroyo.
Aaron Hill with Paul Goldschmidt on deck. Roof and panels open. Bright sunshine here at Chase Field. Strike one. Little looper in a shallow center, and it drops in for a base hit. Your Arizona Ford starting pitcher, Tim Lincecum, last year under 500, an ERA near 4.5, nearly a strikeout for every inning. But a strikeout rate dropped to a career low, velocity down again. Fewer hits allowed than innings pitched. The highlight of his season, the no-hitter against the Padres July 13th at Petco Park.
That was kind of an odd season for Tim Lincecum, a guy that's always had very unusual mechanics, the extravagant stride that he takes toward home plate, and had some trouble with those mechanics. When you have mechanics that are not in the norm, sometimes it's hard to fix it.
Goldie hits the first pitch to the bees, well hit to right center field, and that ball is gone, a home run. Paul Goldschmidt extends his hitting streak, now 25 games. And the Diamondbacks answer, it's 2-1. First pitch swinging. He hit that one to Neptune.
Ooh. That's a long homer.
What is going on here today?
No. Wow. That money that Paul Goldschmidt spends on the limo to bring Tim Lincecum to the team hotel here in town is well spent.
I mean, there's ownage, wow. Man. There's ownage, man. Look
That's
at those numbers.
Crazy numbers.
One pitch.
Martin Prado. Or what a lift that is. Get that run back and then some. Strike one to Prado, batting cleanup today. By the way, Paul Goldschmidt this season, 10 for 23 to start the year. There's Aaron Hill, a little broken bat flare in a center that dropped in. Martin Prado chops it to second. A-Ray Adrianza is there, 2-1.
And we should point out Lincecum features a fastball with very little movement. He throws a two-seamer, but he throws it so pure and over the top that it has very little movement. Serves the purpose of a four-seam fastball in the low 90s. Throws a lot of straight changeups. He'll mix in some sliders and curveballs occasionally, but basically a two-pitch guy with the fastball changeup.
Mark Trumbo steps in. Tim Lincecum had a very good spring, but he's had to overcome a lot just to make this start. First, it was a left knee bruise. He was hit by a line drive last Friday and spent a long night here in Phoenix on Tuesday with food poisoning. That one finds the bees. Trumbo hits it to the wall and heads for second base. Mark Trumbo, his first double this season. And the Diamondbacks are getting to Tim Lincecum and his mustache early here.
Just a nice, easy pass there by Mark Trumbo. A lot of hands, a lot of wrists right at the end of the swing, and that ball just shot into the gap in right center field. Keep hitting balls out in that direction, some of the Giants outfielders will get stung and have to come out of the game.
It's all part of the strategy.
I'm telling you, they're falling right into our trap.
Now if we could just trap those bees. Chris Owings back at shortstop today. Strike one. By grounding out to first. Aaron Hill, little flare in the center for a single. Goldie at his first home run of the year. Prado grounded out. Mark Trumbo a two-out double, and here's Owings. Giants got their run on another Brandon Belt home run in the first against Bronson Arroyo. He borrowed that mustache from Bobby Valentine.
It used to be connected to a fake nose and a pair of glasses.
I think he kind of looks like Peter Sellers from the Pink Panther movies.
His manager, Bruce Bochy, says he is the Rain Man of music. He knows all genres. He knows all the artists. Any music that comes on in the clubhouse, he'll rattle off who the lead singer is, what band he's with, what band he used to be with. And it could be anything from AC/DC to Frank Sinatra to Barbara Streisand to ABBA. He knows it all.
He knows Barbara, huh?
Well, the way she was.
Two-time Cy Young winner, four-time All-Star, but has not had a winning season since 2010. Last 3 years, 33-43, an ERA over four. What a first inning, Bees and Barbara.
Must be getaway day.
Buckle up. Here's the strikeout that ends the first. But Paul Goldschmidt gets his first home run of the season and extends his hitting streak to 25 games. He's only five back at Gonzo for the D-backs record. And welcome back. First pitch to Hunter Pence is a ball to open the second inning. Hunter Pence, Hector Sanchez, Brandon Crawford, 5, 6, and 7. Diamondbacks on a Paul Goldschmidt home run. Lead the Giants 2-1. He's bounced to third. Martin Prado spins and throws. One up, one down. Brad, are you still hovering around the bees out there?
Correct. Chase Field has become a beehive of activity out here. We've actually found out where they're congregating and why. There is a queen bee in the middle of all that fray, and so they're waiting for Louie to come back. He's from Sexton Pest Control, so they want to get all the bees together, and then they'll try to spray them. But the good news, on the upside, they are making honey. So, guys, if you could order some scones, we'll be in business here.
I'm gonna go down and get some Wetzel's pretzels.
That'd be fantastic. But they are actually going to cordon off this area because they are starting to kind of come up on the concourse area. So we're going to get out of here in just a little bit. But that is the situation. The queen bee is to blame.
She always is, at least in my house.
Steve Berthume, ladies and gentlemen.
I hope she's not. Is she watching on the iPad down there?
Well, she was.
Strike two to Hector Sanchez, getting the start behind the plate. Buster Posey the afternoon off. Something Bruce Bochy said earlier this week he would do. Here is the wife. She's getting ready to head to the women's Final Four.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, down in Nashville. We'll be in Denver and San Francisco, bundled up. Protect the pool. That's why we brought in the bees. Kind of backfired, though. They look like they got a whole thing going in that pool with King Neptune out there. And I see an octopus and some mermaids.
Went to a ball game and a Disney movie broke out.
I mean, look at what is she wearing there? She looks like Sigmund and the Sea Monster. I'm not sure what that guy, the blue guy, is. He's the octopus. Yeah. I tell you, you rent the pool for the day, you dress the part. Nice work.
Surprised the crazy crab isn't out there. The Giants briefly had a mascot. They took a fan vote, and the fans decided they did not want the mascot. So they came up with this idea of the crazy crab. And the crazy crab would make an appearance every ball game, run around Candlestick Park, and people would throw things at the crazy crab. It was kind of a running joke, and they lasted about half a season. And I have to tell you that I actually saw the person wearing the crazy crab costume underneath the bleachers one day. He was not a happy man. That's a tough gig.
Why are they so mean to me?
Yeah, I don't get it. But the crazy crab would fit in out there with King Neptune and other characters.
3-2. He just stirs up the water just by his presence.
Tapping his trident on the side of the hot tub there, turned it on.
Right back to the mound. Arroyo has it. Two down. If you show up at the ballpark with a trident, strange things are going to happen.
Unless it's an ASU game, you could probably get away with it over there. Shortstop, number
35, Brandon Crawford. Good to know that our pool is protected now.
I would have liked to have heard that phone call. Hey, what are you doing Thursday afternoon?
I got the pool.
Want to go to the ball game? One condition. You have to dress up like an octopus.
Brandon Crawford. Well, Bronson Arroyo has an excellent track record against the Giants, especially lately. His record the last 10 times he's faced San Francisco is 5-2 with a 1.66 ERA. He has really owned these guys lately. And that does not include that 2012 start in the National League Division Series. He dominated the Giants, 7 innings of one-hit ball. So this is an excellent matchup for the Diamondbacks, given Arroyo's track record against the Giants and Lincecum's recent struggles for the Diamondbacks. Four-pitch walk to Crawford, and it'll work to A. Ray Adrianza. First walk issued by Arroyo.
Second baseman, number 53, A. Ray Adrianza.
Another start at second base for Adrianza. He was out there last night. Saw Joaquin Arias earlier in the series.
Adrianza had an error at second base last night. Tough error, line drive hit his direction, hit right in the middle of that second baseman's glove and popped out. I'll tell you, the way the first game of this series went, I wasn't so sure. There was a lot of defensive miscues, especially by the Giants, a lot of mental miscues. But since that first game, both teams have settled in. We've seen some crisp baseball.
Yeah, we had all those crazy defensive errors in the first game by the Giants, the replay controversy the next game, and now we've had a little bit of everything so far today. Bronson Arroyo looked good when he pitched here last. That was Saturday. Right here at Chase Field, the final spring training game against the Cubs. And gave the all clear in terms of the back issue to start here this afternoon. And you know, with a perfect track record, 15 years in the big leagues, he did not want to open the season on the DL.
No. I mean, there's something to be said for that. I mean, there obviously were a lot of starts over that time period where he probably needed a day off, could have taken a day off, but just didn't want to let his teammates or fans down. That's his job, to take that ball every fifth day, and he's been as good as anybody in the game.
Another 3-2 count here. It's his third three-ball count of the ball game already with Tim Lincecum on deck. Crawford off with a pitch, and there it is. Ring him up and sit him down. First strikeout for Bronson Arroyo. CenturyLink, your link to what's next, coming up. A.J. Pollock leads off the Diamondbacks second against Tim Lincecum. Looks at a ball.
One of the occasional curveballs I mentioned at the top of the show. Doesn't throw a lot of the slower breaking ball. Hey, a couple Dodgers left over from last year's celebration.
You've heard of Ethel Merman. Those are the Mermen. Nice work synchronizing the flippers.
What in the world? Wow.
Right back to the mound, right to Lincecum's glove. One away.
Catcher, number nine.
Tell you what, that's a pretty organized group. Tuffy Gozawish getting the start this afternoon behind the plate. Relaxing day at the ballpark.
I'm going to have to explain this to my kids one day.
You might have to do that. I think all of us, in fact, deserve an explanation.
Yeah, please.
Strike one to Tuffy.
If they would dress like that to go to a ball game, what do you do when you get invited to a costume party?
I think that's it, right?
I would think so.
Tuffy strikes out. That seems like an opportune time, Bob, to remind fans to tweet us your photos. No. Please. Hashtag D-backs fan photo. And you'll have your chance to have it shown on an upcoming Fox Sports Arizona broadcast. So tweet us your fan picks, King Neptune. Just use the hashtag D-backs fan photo, and your photo can appear on a broadcast brought to us by our friends at AT&T. Ball one to Bronson Arroyo. Two strikeouts now for Lincecum. Mentioned Arroyo's good luck against the Giants. Lincecum against the Diamondbacks has been much the opposite. They have had his number lately. Last seven appearances against Arizona, Lincecum is 1-5 with a 6.75 ERA. Here you go. And that's after he won seven of his first 10 career decisions against the Diamondbacks. So started out very well versus Arizona, but lately it's been difficult for him. Hard to believe he'll turn 30 in June. You still think of him as
that
a kid.
That is hard to believe. One of the grizzled veterans on that pitching staff now.
Three strikeouts for Lincecum. We are through two at Chase Field, and the Diamondbacks lead the Giants 2-1. Yeah, that is a Friday to Sunday, April 11th, 12th, and 13th. Strike one to Tim Lincecum. Now, shouldn't we have those guys out there when the Dodgers are here? This seems ill-timed.
This is the color of the merman's costume. A little too close to Dodger blue.
That's what's wrong with that picture for you?
Yeah, just the color.
That's the part that bothers you. The mermen. Now, one of them needs to dress up like Ethel Merman. And they can belt out some show tunes out there. And boy, I'll tell you what, Brad Steinke showed up to work today. Allergic to bees. First thing he had to do was go report on the swarm of bees out there. And now we've sent him over to the pool.
Pretty good chance he's allergic to that, too.
He should be if he's not. How about that stash? That's like a 1970s baseball mustache. Old school. That's Brenly-esque, in fact. Strike three. Let's go out to the pool with Brad.
Yeah, Steve, as you mentioned, what a day as a broadcaster in the middle of a beehive and then out here with this collection of people. This is Logan. Logan, the Neptune Poseidon. Tell me about this group. How did this all come about?
We're here to protect the pool and make sure that we get no interlopers, and anybody that's up here is a D-backs fan all the way through.
Now, will you be here when the Dodgers are in town? You know, the Giants didn't do anything bad to our pool. The Dodgers did. Will you be back for that series?
Oh, most certainly. Whether we're at the pool or anywhere in the stands, we're definitely going to be protecting this pool.
Tell me about the mermen. I mean, you got to be good friends with these guys to have them throw on that type of getup to come out here to the pool.
I didn't even ask. They just
that's just something they have in their closet.
Yeah, immediately, yeah. They offered.
Who doesn't? We got the fisherman over there. Looks like we got an octopus.
Yeah, it's Ursula, the little mermaid here, Ariel. And, yeah, the rest of the crew. And an old fisherman who seems to be catching some nice sharks in here.
Now, is this something you're going to plan to do year in, year out? Is this just a special occasion?
If we can keep going this for a couple of years, we'd love to keep doing it.
Now, my question is, ruler of the sea, are you going to get in the actual pool today?
Guarantee it's getting a little hot in this thing.
Guys, we'll send it back up to you. It is it's a unique scene. I'll put it that way.
Oh, it's a scene, man. I don't know about you, BB, but I feel more comfortable, frankly, knowing they're there. Base hit for Pagan in the run.
I just love the effort. I mean, that's not something easy. You know, you don't wake up in the morning and just grab it out of the closet. You have to think ahead and get the whole group together.
Well, mission accomplished.
Mission accomplished. Very well planned attack on the pool.
Suddenly I'm in the mood for some fish sticks. Gregor Blanco. Apparently they're biting.
I know for a fact there are no fish in that pool,
or you would have caught.
I'd have been in there by now.
Blanco grounded out his first time. Watch out for Pagan. Already has a stolen base in this series. Breaking ball in there, first strike. Routine for Parra.
Oh, I have a moment. Let's take a look at our Valley Honda keys to the game. Probably should have put these up in the first inning before Brandon belts at bat. But anytime Bronson Arroyo is on the mound, you want to keep the ball in the ballpark, as if at all possible. We mentioned earlier he's going to give up his share of homers, hopefully all solos. And friendly confines here at Chase Field haven't been so friendly when the D-backs are playing the Giants. Giants have won 9 of the last 12 here at the D-backs home ballpark.
And Brandon Belt, 3 home runs in the series so far. He homered his first time up. Arroyo, one pitch this time. And that's it. One hit, they leave one. Bottom three, Diamondbacks lead it 2-1. And it's the top of the order here against Tim Lincecum in the third. Parra, Hill, Goldschmidt, 1-2-3. Ball one to Parra, who grounded out his first time up. Gorgeous sunny day here in downtown Phoenix. Roof and panels are wide open, nothing but blue skies. Parra trying to bunt here, and it goes foul. What a day to be out here. Mm-hmm. We're headed to Denver right after the ball game, where they got 4 inches of snow this morning.
Perfect.
Awesome.
We have the Saturday and Sunday games on Fox Sports Arizona 40.
Yeah, opening day in at Coors Field tomorrow. That place will be rocking.
Yeah, and then we have opening day at AT&T Park against these Giants on Tuesday.
That place is rocking every game.
Great ballparks in this division. Buster Posey getting a well-deserved day off. We've talked throughout the series about how Posey really wore down during the second half of last season. His offensive numbers just plummeted. And so Bruce Bochy's paying special attention to getting Buster more days off, so he's not so gassed by the time they get to the All-Star break. And I guess Bob, and at least today, say the same thing for Kurt Gibson and Miguel Montero.
Yeah. Well, you pick your spots over the course of a season. A lot of times it'll be a day game after a night game. Pay close attention to the opposing pitchers over the next couple of series and see if there's a particular matchup that's tough for your catcher and give him that day off.
Two balls and two strikes to Gerardo Parra. That's in fair territory. Belt has it. And that's five in a row set down by Lincecum. There's David Hernandez, just back from Pensacola, Florida. Tommy John surgery from Dr. Andrews. Four Diamondbacks pitchers right now on the DL with Tommy John. Although the news on Daniel Hudson has been very encouraging. He's throwing off the mound. And he is on track to be back in July. Not as a starting pitcher, but as a reliever. He will remake his career in the bullpen, which they think will help with the wear and tear on that elbow, which has had two Tommy Johns now. But good to see David back here. Aaron Hill singled in the first, came in on the Goldie homer.
I'm sure it's big for David to be here today as well. That's one of the tough things when you have an injury and you find yourself on the disabled list. You kind of feel separated from the guys who you were so close to just a couple of days before when you were an active player. Stay in the mix. Stay around your teammates. David's got a lot to offer, even though he can't take the ball and go out there on the mound and pitch. He knows these hitters in the league. He can help some of the other pitchers on the staff, maybe give them some advice. Sitting there talking to Miguel Montero.
And you'll see Patrick Corbin here all the time. We've seen Daniel Hudson over the last year or so. Matt Reynolds is here nearly every day, of course.
As an active player, I have to say that was without a doubt the toughest thing I ever had to go through in my career, when I spent some time on the disabled list to start the 1982 season with a broken collarbone. When you have to sit home and watch the games on television, that is just killer. Especially when you feel like, hey, if I was there, I could do something to help the team. If I was there, I could do this or that. But you're just helpless. You're just a spectator.
Struck him out on the 3-2 pitch. Four strikeouts now for Lincecum. Two down in the third.
First baseman. Oh,
this is the first inning, and once again, in fact, on one pitch, Paul Goldschmidt, right to Poseidon, just tortures Tim Lincecum. 11 for 21, six homers. very one-sided matchup. Miss with a breaking ball away, and it's 2-0.
As he figures if Goldie's going to get him this time, he's going to have to supply his own power. That slow curveball just off the plate away.
One of the things been talked about with Lincecum is the diminished velocity. He just does not throw as hard as he used to. And this spring, it was generally 89-91. We've seen that today. 3-1. So Lincecum says he has learned to pitch with the lesser velocity. Not worried about it because he says he's realized it's all about placement. This is one nicely there, and it's 3-2.
Boy, all off-speed pitches. This at bat for Paul Goldschmidt. Some breaking pitches, some straight change-ups when he's been behind in counts. It's like a changeup coming here.
Goldie shoots it down the right field line. Pence over to cut it off. And Goldie heads for second. And the throw is in time. Hunter Pence moved over there quickly. That wasn't the greatest base running decision Goldie ever made. And Hunter Pence throws him out. But Paul Goldschmidt so far 2-for-2. And through three, the Diamondbacks lead the Giants 2-1. For your buck with the D-backs value pack, that includes a bleacher ticket, a hot dog, or a Subway sandwich, regular Pepsi, and a free cookie, all for only $21. For more information, visit dbacks.com/value. Ball one to Pablo Sandoval, who leads off the fourth. Sandoval, Pence, Sanchez, 4, 5, and 6. Grounded out to short his first time. Knocks it the other way and shoots it down the line into the left field corner. The Pandas on the run. Trumbo fishes it out of there, and Pablo Sandoval has his first double this season. Leadoff man aboard for the Giants.
Well, this is the approach that usually works pretty well against Bronson Arroyo. Just really focus on going to the opposite field. He's going to throw you a lot of pitches from the middle of the plate away, whether you're a right-handed hitter or a left-handed hitter. He's hoping to take advantage of your aggressiveness trying to pull the ball. That time Sandoval shot it down into that left field corner.
Hunter Pence still looking for his first hit this season. He is 0-for-13. Sandoval had to hold up. Tim Flannery will stop him at third.
Catcher Hector Sanchez.
Oh, hit on a line just over the head of Chris Owens. You could see Sandoval right there had to wait to make sure the ball got through so he didn't run himself into a double play. And by the time he gets to third base, Tim Flannery, the coach there, has no choice but to hold him up.
So the first two have reached against Arroyo here in the fourth, and it's Hector Sanchez. He tapped back to the mound his first time. Strike one. Sanchez last season 63 games at 248 with 3 homers. As he was in and out of the lineup all last year with shoulder injuries. But they like his bat and they want to see him play more, get more chances.
When you're the backup catcher on a team that has Buster Posey, you're not going to get an inordinate amount of playing time. But the fact that he's a left-handed bat, they like to use him as a pinch hitter occasionally late in a ball game to get a matchup.
Yeah, he had a big offseason, too, actually getting smaller. Worked hard to drop 20 pounds at the suggestion using finger quotes, of the Giants. They wanted to see him in a little better shape. Says he feels like his energy levels much better this year.
And ideally for the Giants, that'll translate into a little more mobility behind the plate. Sanchez, as you said, more known for his offense than his defense. And when he was carrying that extra tonnage around, he didn't move too well behind the plate last year. Let's just put it that way.
Ball and two strikes. Drives that down the line in right, but pulls it. He's got a little pop in that bat, there's no question. Yeah, there, the Pandu dropped anywhere between 30 and 40 pounds, and Sanchez, who's down 20. Sanchez had a really good spring, hit 320 with two home runs. As he continues to improve, they have to find ways to give Posey a break now and then, so it works out. In fact, Bochy, who told us that Sanchez would start today, has not even committed to starting Buster Posey in all three games against the Dodgers this weekend. The Giants go from here to LA. 1-2 pitch. Nice block by Tuffy. Goes a wish behind the plate, saved a run. That's a run right there.
Boy, those are the toughest ones to block to, the ball that hits that far out in front of home plate. Middle of the infield. He gets the glove on it, able to keep it in front right there, hold that runner at third, hold Hunter Pence over there at first.
Well, nice he is a dirt dog.
He is a real dirt dog.
Sandoval, the runner at third, Pence at first. 2-2 to Hector Sanchez. He lifts that in the air, high and deep to right center field. A.J. Pollock at the track near the bees. He has it. Sandoval tags, and the game is tied. Nice at bat there by Hector Sanchez. It's 2-2.
I made a loud sound coming off of Sanchez's bat, but fortunately hit it out there to the deepest part of the park, and Pollock had just enough room to run underneath and make the catch, but the Giants tie it up on that sac fly.
So one out, Hunter Pence still a runner at first. And the batter is Brandon Crawford. He walked his first time. There's a strike, 0-1.
I wonder what Arroyo feels about that sac fly right there. I mean, obviously didn't want to give up a run, but if he gives up that same fly ball at Great American Ballpark in Cincinnati, it hits the riverboat out there in center field.
That is a teeny tiny little ballpark. Somehow, as an extreme fly ball pitcher, he not only survived there, but thrived. That speaks to just how effective he can be the rest of the time. Breaking ball in there, first round. Last time Bronson Arroyo missed a start, he was 9 years old. He was shot in the leg with a spear gun. I'm not kidding. He grew up in Florida, a big fisherman. Missed the second half of his youth baseball season. Said that's the only time he can ever remember being down. 0-2. More on Bronson Arroyo, the Coors Light Cold Hard Facts. On the Diamondbacks' new starting pitcher. Never missed a start. He's got a World Series ring. Big part of that 04 Red Sox team that broke the 86-year curse. And he is a big BB guitar player.
Oh, he's a good guitar player. He can sing. Got some CDs out.
Yeah, he is a self-taught. Teaches others to play as well. Says he's got about 200 songs in his head. Started off as a hobby. As Bob mentioned, cut an album. The first CD came out in July of 05. It was called Covering the Bases. Mostly 90s rock. He's a big Pearl Jam guy. He said the best part of all that was he got to go to the Grammys. Nice. And at the Grammys, he got to sit next to Leonard Skinner.
How about that?
That was the highlight.
Well, among other things, Bronson Arroyo is just a good guy. They have an award in Cincinnati they give every year called the Joe Nuxall Good Guy Award, and he won it four times as a member of the Reds. And we've talked a lot about the D-backs and how they not just want to throw guys together. They want to make sure they're the right kind of guys, guys that will be accountable and stand up and be responsible to their teammates and take an active role in the community. And Bronson Arroyo has done that his entire career.
The great Joe Nuxall.
Oh, he was a beauty.
Get Bronson to jam on that thing here at the team shop. I noticed one of those made its way up here.
Yeah, how about that?
What a coincidence.
Well, that's a beauty.
You can purchase that at the team shop here. Another 2-2 to Brandon Crawford. Gotta watch out for Hunter Pence. He was an extremely efficient base dealer last year.
I tell you, he's hiking those pants up higher and higher every year. They're above his knee now.
Looks like a cricket player. 3-2.
Yeah, I love it when a plan comes together.
Beautiful, huh? Hunter Pence running with a pitch, foul back.
Another thing a lot of people don't know about Bronson Arroyo, we've seen him make a couple of nice plays on balls hit back to the mound in this game. He won a gold glove back in 2010. He moves around pretty good out there on the mound.
Well, Crawford's making him work here. Ninth pitch of the at bat on the way. There goes Pence again, misses ball four. Second walk issued by Arroyo. So far in this inning, a double, a single, a sac fly RBI, and now a base on balls. He's walked Crawford twice today.
Yeah, it's just a little guesswork on my part, but I think he feels more comfortable facing young A. Ray Adrianza than he does Brandon Crawford in that particular situation. A lot of veteran pitchers, when they get down to the bottom of that batting order, they pick a guy that they know they can get out, or at least they feel that they can get out if they execute their pitches. And being very careful with Brandon Crawford twice in this ball game, he was able to strike out Adrianza last time he faced him.
Hunter Pence the runner at second, Brandon Crawford at first, a run in here in the fourth. Ball one. A-Ray Adrianza, the starter again today at second base. From Venezuela, signed with the Giants in 2006. He's 24. And as we mentioned earlier this week, his godfather is Ozzie Guillen. Adrianza's father grew up in Venezuela with Ozzie. And Ozzie's a legend down there.
Not so much in Miami.
Lifts that in the air to right center field. A.J. Pollock. He's got it. Hunter Pence tags and heads to third.
Pitcher Tim Lincecum.
Brings up Tim Lincecum with two down. He struck out looking his first time up. Sandoval doubled. Pence singled. Sandoval came in on a Sanchez sack fly to tie the ball game. A walk to Crawford. Pence moves to third on the fly ball by Adrianza. And here's Lincecum. Strike one. Pitch count is creeping up. Number 75 on the way. Oh, and two. Two games against the Rockies for you on Fox Sports Arizona. Back with you Saturday. Brandon McCarthy at Coors Field. Randall Delgado pitches Friday. No TV on that game. Crawford off with a pitch. No throw from Tuffy Gozuwish, keeping an eye on Pence at third. And there's a stolen base for Crawford.
Like Crawford had a pretty good jump over there at first base. Tuffy throws extremely well, but with that kind of jump, you don't want to risk a throw to second base, possibly hit the runner, maybe short hop into the bag and allow Pence to walk home from third base. Take your chances with Lincecum up there at the plate.
A ball and two strikes. Seven pitches, 47 for strikes. Big strikeout, he strands two, but the Giants bring another run across as we head to the home half of the fourth at Chase Field. It's a 2-2 ball game. Martin Prado leads off the fourth. Prado, Trumbo, Owings, 4-5-6 against Tim Lincecum. 2-4-0 for the Giants, 2-4-0 for the Diamondbacks. Prado grounded out his first time. Tim Hudson was fantastic last night for the Giants, of course, great sinker ball pitcher. And he's proven to be a great resource for Tim Lincecum. And Lincecum has said that Hudson has talked to him about location, about dividing the strike zone horizontally. So imagine a horizontal line across the strike zone. And he's told Lincecum, just focus on throwing to the bottom half of the zone. And rely on movement in your pitches. Don't worry about being able to get guys with the pitches up. Just get it down, keep it down. And Lincecum said that mentality and simplifying his approach has really, really helped him. High chopper to third. Sandoval got a hurry. Barehanded. Boy, he's got an arm.
Played that one nicely, waited for that last hop, and sometimes when you do that, especially on a barehanded play, the ball doesn't always come up exactly the way you expect it to, but you're doing much better than Kung Fu Panda does right there. Nice and smooth, got his body in position, so when he did make the barehand play, he was ready to throw.
Mark Trumbo doubled his first time up. Mark off to a good start with the Diamondbacks. He is a 6-for-22 as he steps in. Chance for Crawford at short. Two up, two down.
Hey, fans, when the D-backs win, you win at Papa John's. The day after every D-backs win, you get 50% off your regular menu price online order at Papa John's. Enter promo code DBACKS50 at papajohns.com.
Chris Owings, a strikeout victim his first time. Beautiful sunny day here at Chase Field. Feet up, kick back, relax, and watch the Diamondbacks. Lincecum has thrown strike one to every hitter in this inning. Trying to keep the ball down.
You know, the story you told about Tim Hudson and the advice he gave to Lincecum about the horizontal line. There was a time Tim Lincecum didn't worry about any lines in the strike zone. He's just going to rear back and blow it right on by you. He would throw 97 in the first inning, throw 97 in the ninth inning.
Isn't that represent the fact that he pitches down more now, him adjusting to this diminished velocity?
I think, and I give him a lot of credit for it. You know, some guys can't make that adjustment. Once a power pitcher, always a power pitcher. But, you know, like you said, watching a guy like Tim Hudson, who, you know, early on in his career was able to do the same things Lincecum did early in his career. And once you lose a little bit of velocity, you have to find ways to make up for it. And command is certainly one of the easier ways to do it.
Chris Owings drives that to right. It lands in front of Hunter Pence, and Owings has a base hit. It's his seventh hit this season.
Center field, A.J. Pollock.
I really like his approach in the early going here. Everything's up the middle, opposite field. He's not getting out in front of too many pitches. He's not getting fooled by a lot of off-speed deliveries. Seems like he's seeing the ball very well. I think that's a great approach. I think as he gets more comfortable and sees how teams are going to pitch him, you might see him pull the ball a little bit more.
A.J. Pollock. Another strike one from Lincecum. Lincecum learned a term from Tim Hudson talking about working down in the zone and relying on your stuff. He says the goal is not strikeouts anymore, like when you were talking about. The goal now, he says, this is his term, is crappy contact. That's keep it down. Make sure they don't barrel it up and hope to get crappy contact. Little choppers, little rollers in the infield. And Hudson is the king of that.
Oh, yeah. Now, they're, you know, vaguely similar in build. Both, you know, very slender guys out there on the mound. Not real tall. Take full advantage of everything they have at their disposal out there. So I think Tim Hudson would be a very good guy to model yourself after as your career moves forward in the case of Tim Lincecum.
Now the difference for him this spring, he's okay with throwing any pitch in any count. And that's made a big difference for him.
Well, we've seen quite a bit of that in this game already. 2-0 change up to Paul Goldschmidt earlier in the ball game. A 3-1 change up, came right back with a 3-2 change up.
Nothing doing there.
We don't run on pitch outs. Somebody always yells that from the dugout. When you pitch out and the runner's not going, somebody will always yell, "We don't run on pitch outs."
Never gets old. There goes Owings. Pollock strikes out. That's five strikeouts now for Tim Lincecum, and through four, it's a 2-2 ball game. Toronto sneaking into the edge of the grass at third. Pagan follows that one behind the Diamondback dugout. We pointed out at the top of the show that Bronson's leg is almost a flat parallel to the ground, and the foot is way up there near his head. He said that started when he was 7 years old. He watched Dwight Gooden. And as kids do, he went out there trying to emulate the Doc Gooden delivery, and it stuck.
I think I said it at the top of the show, it lends to the deception as well. Hitting is all about timing and trying to get into a rhythm with that pitcher and his delivery. I had a hitting coach tell me one time, when the pitcher shows you his back pocket, you show him your back pocket, meaning that as he turns.
Pagan turns on that one. It's over the head of Parra. Bangs against the fence out there. Pagan will stop at second. That's his second hit and his second double this year.
Just to quickly finish that thought, there has to be some timing as that pitcher goes through his windup. There's a certain windup that you have as well as a hitter. Get a look at Pagan lining that ball to right field. And when a pitcher has something that disrupts that rhythm and disrupts that timing, makes it harder for you to be on time when that ball's in the hitting zone, that's going to work in a pitcher's favor. I think Clayton Kershaw has a lot of herky jerky in his delivery that is very deceptive to a hitter. Hideo Nomo back in the day, the tornado. Very tough to get into a rhythm with his windup as a hitter.
Blanco bunts it up the first baseline. Arroyo pounces on it. Nice play. Pagan moves up to third.
We were talking earlier today about the various arm angles for Bronson Arroyo. Going to get a look at three of them here. That's about what I would call three-quarters delivery. Tried to drop a breaking ball on the outside corner. That's almost pure sidearm there. Just a flat slider that ended up off the plate inside, pulled foul, and then that's almost directly over the top. And as a hitter, you just get a lot of different looks.
Kirk Gibson to the mound. Arroyo right now at 82 pitches, 51 for strikes. Oliver Perez has been throwing in the Sanderson Ford D-backs bullpen. And this appears to be a discussion. I guess when you're in your 15th major league season, you get a vote. This might be just a check on the back as well.
They had to bounce off the mound to field that bunt, kind of an awkward bend, scoop and throw all at once. And Kirk Gibson has made the determination that that's going to be it for Bronson Arroyo today.
So we'll see Oliver Perez. Bronson Arroyo's day ends here. We'll take a break from Chase Field. On here's Ollie Perez, who's on for the second time in this series. He worked the series opener on Monday, faced three batters, and did not record an out. Gave up a double to Pagan, a single to Belt, and a single to Sandoval. And he will face Belt and Sandoval here. Brandon Belt. Three home runs in this series, including one in the first against Arroyo. That was the first giant run. And we were talking, Bob, about Bronson Arroyo's different arm angles. Ollie Perez throws a little bit of everything at you.
Yeah, he might throw it behind his back from time to time. He'll do the Louis Tiant wind up, you know, turn his back completely to home plate at times. He'll throw down near sidearm. He'll throw up over the top.
He's ahead 0-2. Infield in on the grass. Belt pops it up. Shallow center. This could be trouble. Chris Owings was in on the grass. Had to go a long way back there to get it. And Owings has it. Two down. Nice play. Nice Pullmenter warming. You imagine that he would get Hunter Pence if Sandoval reaches. Oliver Perez once had a pitching coach who said sometimes you don't know whether he wants to be Satchel Paige or Don Drysdale. It's fun to watch. He will attack hitters and bury those release points and windups. The Panda doubled and scored his last time up. He's 1-for-2. Angel Pagan making a lot of noise over there at third with his feet. There's Perez, the left-hander, with his back turned to third base. And Pagan trying to rattle him a bit down the third base line. There's the little Louis Tiant. Another pop-up. Looks like Aaron Hills. Battle of that sun, and he's got it. Good job by Oliver Perez. Retires Belt and Sandoval. And they strand Pagan at third. That keeps the ball game tied up. CenturyLink, your link to what's next when we come back. Arno Parra, red hot to start the season. 2-5-0 for the Giants, 2-5-0 for the Diamondbacks. Tuffy Gozuwish leads off the fifth against Tim Lincecum. First pitch swing and fouled back. Pitcher spot is due up next, and Tony Campana is in the on-deck circle. Good job there by Oliver Perez to get to two real good hitters there with a runner on third. That one got away from Lincecum, 1-1. Sherlock, the great ones, never lose it.
He's adapting to that third base coaching job well. Look how far behind the coach's box he is down there. Any right-handed possible pull hitter at the plate, get as far away from the dish as you can.
Bounce to third, Sandoval. Sherlock, the new third base coach, longtime bullpen coach. Out in the sunshine today here, Chase. No longer lurking in the shadows. Conversation now, Bronson Arroyo and pitching coach Mike Harkey. Didn't appear to be any kind of a back concern. He's certainly not getting any treatment or anything like that. So I guess the fact he's still in the dugout is a good sign in terms of his health.
Yeah, we talked about it last night. I'm pretty sure I'll check with Bronson. I don't think he ever ices his shoulder or his elbow after a ball game. Where most starting pitchers come out of the game, they watch the remainder of that half inning, and then they go up to the trainer's room to start getting some treatments, get some ice on their arm. Bronson just going to hang out on the bench, watch the rest of the ball game.
He has a very unique fitness regimen that he has adhered to since he was 7 or 8 years old. And it almost never changes. It started young. His father, Gus, emigrated from Cuba, worked in the roofing business. And Gus was a competitive power lifter. This is a guy that could bench press 440.
Jeez.
Yeah, that was his dad. He had Bronson working out as a kid. Campana swinging bunt, two down. So Gus had Bronson. They built a little homemade backyard weight room when he was five. It wasn't like a little league parent thing, but he wanted him to understand that if you take care of your body, you stay on top of your health and fitness, you can build a solid foundation. And he has a, you can do that at Mountainside Fitness here at the ballpark too. Mountainside Fitness, that is a tremendous facility here. Not just if you're at Chase Field, but if you're in the downtown area, get your workout in. Yeah, so Bronson has his own thing he does.
Well, and given his track record and the way he's taken the ball for, what would you say, 9 straight years without missing a start.
Yeah.
Father knows best.
Especially when father can bench press 440.
Yeah.
Never been on the DL. 14 major league seasons. This is number 15 here. Speaking of bench pressing, what happened to the undersea extravaganza we had out there? Poseidon pack it in? No, he's still out there. Yeah, the whole crew is there. The merman is there. One of them anyway. Two and two to Gerardo Parra. Called strike three. That's 7 strikeouts for Lincecum, and Parra can't believe it. Pat Hoberg says strike three. And Bronson Arroyo, Oliver Perez, and now the right-hander Colemantor on for the third time this year. Colemantor will face Hunter Pence, Hector Sanchez, and Brandon Crawford, 5, 6, and 7. Hunter Pence 1-for-2. He singled his last time up, his first hit this season. Way out in front of that one. Clemente started him off at 77 miles an hour. This whole game with this pitching staff we've seen, if you include Lincecum and Arroyo and Perez and Colmenter, just he could do a clinic on arm angles and different windups and deliveries. Popped up in the air, easy one for A.J. Pollock in center. Hey fans, play Kachinko by signing up at one of the 16 interactive kiosks right here at Chase Field during any Arizona Diamondbacks regular season home game. And what a day it is to be here today. Look at that. Panels in the outfield open, the roof open. Not a cloud in the sky in downtown Phoenix.
Some of the breezy conditions we had throughout this four-game series have disappeared today. Absolutely beautiful day for a ball game.
Hector Sanchez, first pitch. Goldie backhands it, spins and throws. What a play by the Gold Glover at first base. Let's make that our Chaz Roberts air conditioning cool play of the game.
Brandon Crawford.
And you may ask yourself, how does Goldie make so many plays over in that hole between first and second? It's because he plays as far off the first baseline as any first baseman in the game, even with the left-handed hitter at the plate that time, or a switch hitter rather, hitting from the left side. He's off the line, which allows him to cover some of those balls in that hole between first and second that normally would get through into right field for a base hit.
Brandon Crawford has walked twice. And the man that Kirk Gibson always credits for that, teaching Goldie to play off that line, is Lyle Overbay, who was here when Goldie first broke in. Overbay now playing first for the Brewers this season. 0-2. Colmenter jumps ahead here. Josh Colmenter, a nice, easy 1-2-3-6. Home half all the way. It's 2-2 at Chase Field. Tim Lincecum rolling along here. He has his 7 strikeouts. He struck out 3 of the last 4 he's faced. And he's up there against Aaron Hill to lead off the 6th. Hill, Goldschmidt, Prado, 2-3-4. Aaron Hill has singled and scored and struck out 1-for-2. Singled in the first, came in the Paul Goldschmidt homer. Goldie's first of the year. Popped up first base side. Belt gets it a look, but it's just behind the dugout.
For all the affiliates for the Diamondbacks tonight, opening their minor league seasons. Reno Aces against El Paso, Double A Mobile against Mississippi, Single A Advanced Visalia versus Stockton, and the South Bend Silverhawks at Bowling Green to open their seasons. Good luck to all those teams, and good luck to the managers and coaches. They're going to have a long summer in the minor leagues. When you're a manager or coach, that's a full-time job, boys. Phil Nevin, the manager, Mike Parrott, the pitching coach, and Greg Gross, the hitting coach in Reno.
Boy, that's a good staff.
That's a really good staff, accompanied by trainer Joe Metz, who's probably the busiest guy in the world.
To right, base hit for Aaron Hill. He's 2-for-3. Leadoff man aboard in the 6th.
Get up on your toes, Aaron Hill. Tommy Hawk. Dave Bell used to hit that pitch up there around his shoulder. Tomahawk it into right field.
Paul Goldschmidt. What else is new? Two for two, a home run and a single, although Goldie got himself thrown out on an ill-advised attempt to stretch the single into a double. That ended the third. It was a rare Paul Goldschmidt base running mistake. He's an excellent base runner. But when he looked out to right field and decided to stretch it for second, you thought, uh-oh.
I mean, that's the time to try to stretch it to second base with two outs in the inning. Try to get yourself into scoring position. But this probably not the best judgment on that particular one. Hunter Pence was to the ball already. Made a nice throw into second base, and Goldie had no chance.
Remember, Hunter Pence threw out Mark Trumbull at third earlier in this series. And he does an excellent job of cutting off balls down the line and in the gap and getting it back in the infield. 2-0.
And playing the fade, too. You know, he throws from a low three-quarters arm angle. Most outfielders try to get up on top, as you see where Paul Goldschmidt ranks in the Diamondbacks' all-time hit streak, sneaking up on Gonzo. Back to Hunter Pence, most outfielders try to throw straight over the top if they can to get that pure backspin, get a lot of carry on their throws, much truer throw. Hunter Pence throws from a low three-quarter arm angle, gets a lot of tailing action. But he knows it, and he plays it.
Played all 162 games last year for the Giants. Hunter Pence. And that had not happened in a long, long time. In fact, the last guy to do it, Alvin Dark, 1954. Got under it just a bit, and there is Hunter Pence fighting the sun, trying to find it up there. And they retire Goldie.
Right side, definitely the sun field now, judging from the shadows and Giants infielders and Hunter Pence out there in right field. Those guys on that right side are looking right up into the afternoon sun. You see the shadow right behind Hunter Pence out there in right field.
You can't even see Blanco in left. He's in the dark.
He's using his bare hand to shield his eyes, has the sunglasses on, makes a last second adjustment to get underneath the ball, make the play.
That's what he's looking up into here. Aaron Hill is in there with a stolen base. Caught him napping.
Lenskin can take a while to unwind and release that ball to home plate. He has a little turn with his back toward home plate before wheeling to deliver the pitch. Good quick release by Sanchez. They had no chance to get Aaron Hill.
0-1 to Martin Prado, who's 0-2. Prado off to a 3-for-23 start. Lincecum covers and Aaron Hill moves up to third. And she is warming up for the Giants. Saw him earlier in this year. So the go-ahead runs at third base for the Diamondbacks. Two away. The hitter is Mark Trumbo, who's 1-for-2. He doubled in the first. RBI spot. The new guys are doing well, Mark Trumbo and Chris Owings, but to some of the other mainstays, Aaron Hill, Martin Prado, AJ Pollock have got off to slow starts. Both Trumbo and Owings each have a hit today. Aaron Hill to go ahead run at third.
Ideally, everybody's swinging a hot bat when the season starts, but the reality is you have to ham and egg it. A couple guys are going to be hot, a couple guys not so hot. We just hope it all comes together well so that when the hot hitters come to the plate, somebody's in scoring position.
Two balls and a strike to Mark Trumbo. Drives that one to center field. Pagan looking up, and that ball is gone. A home run. Mark Trumbo, his second of the season, and it's a 4-2 Diamondbacks lead. Now 8 RBIs on the year for Mark Trumbo.
Boy, that is some easy power right there. It's a change up, up and out over the plate. Recognizes it well, keeps his hands back, and just flips that ball out of the ballpark.
Wow. He can just crush him. And 2 to Chris Owings, single his last time. In the right. I would just point out that Trumbo and Owings were both off to good starts. They're both 2 for 3 today.
Got that. And once again, an opposite field single this time by Chris Owings. I love that approach for a young hitter. Usually you're over anxious. You want to get out in front of everything. You want to prove that you belong in the big leagues and try to drive the ball to your pull field. But the better approach is to be quick, stay compact, let that ball get deep in the hitting zone, and shoot it into right field or back up the middle.
Chris Owings is 8 for 17 to start the year. Dave Righetti on the mound. And there they are, the dynamic duo. Still haven't come up with a nickname. The best one we heard this winter was Galumbo. Which is terrible, but still, it's the leader in the clubhouse. It's early yet, though.
Yeah, very early.
You know, Galumbo, like Peter Falk, they kind of, you know, they put on wrinkled raincoats. They fight crime. They solve mysteries.
Well, as soon as the governor decrees what the nickname will be, then we'll all know.
That is the official proclamation. Owings takes off the throw from Sanchez. Diamondbacks running wild here on the bases. Aaron Hill has stolen base, and now Chris Owings. Is that a result of seeing something with Lincecum?
I think so. Lincecum is slow to the plate, as I mentioned, when he uses that high leg kick. Occasionally, he'll try a slide step, but he doesn't like to. He doesn't feel as effective when he uses the slide step, so Diamondbacks are just taking off on that first movement and stealing bases easily.
So Chris Owings, 2 for 2 in stolen base attempts this year. He's a good base runner, good speed. What a combination. Got some serious beef down there. Trumbo 6'4", 235. Right to the Panda. An Aaron Hill single. Mark Trumbo, his second home run as a Diamondback. And through 6, the D-backs lead the Giants 4-2. Mark Trumbo, watch it go.
Yesterday on the bench, you know, watching the game, talking about what he might do to these hitters. It's a really good time to catch him. You know, he does a lot of different things. He's not your typical right-hander. You know, he throws his game, and he has success with his game. So it's going to be fun, and it's going to be interesting to see what happens.
And Tuffy goes with our Geico quote of the game. You can tell this week, this homestand, this start was very special for the former ASU product, making his first opening day roster and getting a chance to catch a guy like Bronson Arroyo. A real special treat for Tuffy.
Thank you, Brad. They seemed to work pretty well together. And now he's catching Josh Kohlmenter, who was superb in the sixth, worked a 1-2-3 inning, and is back out here for the seventh. A-Ray Adrianza. The pitcher spot is due up next. That would be Lincecum, but Brandon Hicks is in the on-deck circle. So it's 8-9-1 here in the San Francisco 7th. That one got Tuffy a bit.
I tell you, catching a guy like Bronson Arroyo, and as Tuffy said, they worked together a lot in spring training. They talked a lot leading up to this start today. But when you catch a guy that throws as many different pitches as Bronson Arroyo does, and so many different arm angles, in, out, up, down, you can think yourself into a defensive slump behind the plate. But I thought Tuffy did a real good job today.
Two balls and two strikes to A-Ray Adrianza. Off the fist, a one hopper to Owings at short. One up, one down, four straight set down by Kohlmenter. We saw Brandon Hicks last night. He came in to pinch hit in the ninth and drew a walk against Ryan Roland Smith.
Pinch hitting.
And
he
was up there hitting for Tim Lincecum.
14, Brandon Hicks.
Brandon Hicks did not play in the big leagues last year. Spent the year in the Mets system, mostly at AAA Las Vegas. He hit 283 there with 11 home runs. Ball one. Josh Kohlmenter is off to an outstanding start this year. Josh worked 9 Cactus League games, nearly 13 innings, and had an ERA of 0. And he's looking great today. 1-2.
When you think about Josh Kohlmenter, I mean, obviously he has very unique mechanics himself, but he's a two-pitch guy.
Fastball change.
And you think about pitchers going into spring training and trying to develop your secondary pitches, sometimes a slider, sometimes a curve or a split. He's got two pitches to get ready, and one of them is locked and loaded. The fastball's ready the first day he gets to spring training. So he probably gets a little bit further ahead of the game earlier in spring than a lot of pitchers do.
Less to work on. It's full 3-2. He does try to mix in that curveball, but it's kind of a Haley's Comet deal. Every once in a while. That one is well hit to left. High and deep. Will it stay fair? It is gone. Brandon Hicks, a pinch hit homer, makes it a one-run ball game.
Trying to come inside with a fastball, didn't get it in far enough. Belt high, inner third of the plate. Brandon Hicks really put a charge on that ball. Up into the second deck out there, right down the left field line.
Angel Pagan 2-for-3, doubled his last time. Strike one. That was not a cheapie.
Not at all, man. a pitch either needed to be a little farther inside or a little higher, one or the other. But that was right there on a tee on that inside part of the plate.
Rolled over to second. Aaron Hill is there. Well, the Giants, as Bob mentioned at the top of the show, a lot of success in this ballpark. They've won 13 of their last 18 here. Haven't lost a series at Chase Field in 2 years.
Some of that could be a comfort factor. I know a number of the Giants players make their offseason home here in the Valley of the Sun. So for a lot of these guys, they're coming back to sleep in their own bed.
Yeah, spring training in Scottsdale. Yeah. Gregor Blanco. And trouble looms in the shadows on deck in Brandon Belt. There's a left-hander warming in the bullpen. Looks like Ryan Roland Smith, who we saw last night, pitches first or make his first big league appearance since 2010. The Hyphenator. 3-0. Fomenter after the home run by Hicks got a quick ground ball from Pagan, but he's behind now to Blanco. And you don't want to put anyone on base ahead of Brandon Belt. There's a strike, 3-1. It's full. What would you expect here? 3-2, knowing what he throws?
Change up.
Just missed upstairs. And here comes trouble.
First baseman Brandon Belt.
Well, this is what Brandon Belt has done in this series. See the pitch middle in. It's Wade Miley, middle in. Brandon McCarthy, middle in. We talked a little bit about Belt's mechanical changes, and one of those was being a little more squared up with his shoulders. In the past, he's really had a tendency to close up that front shoulder almost to the point where he could not get to inside pitches. Now that they've got his shoulders squared up just a little bit more, he is so quick on pitches from the middle in, and he's proven that in this series.
Diamondbacks carrying 13 pitchers, and with three lefties in the bullpen, there's no way that Colmenter faces Belt here. Mike Harkey out there to stall for time. Pat Hoberg has broken that up. Kirk Gibson moving to the top step.
It'll be Colmenter. That was a visit to the mound by the pitching coach Mike Harkey, and required to pitch to one more hitter after a visit to the mound before you can make a change.
Well, Ryan Roland Smith has been throwing. He's in the bullpen, but it will be Colmenter.
Well, this could be an indication of the confidence that Mike Harkey and Kirk Gibson have in Josh Colmenter. Certainly more experience, trusting his command that he'll keep the ball out of that middle end zone that Brandon Belt has just been beaten on in this series.
And you see the career numbers too. Belt 1-for-3 today, the solo homer in the first. Brad Ziegler also warming up out there in the Sanderson Ford bullpen. There is the hyphen. Little roller to second. Aaron Hill, Colmenter wiggles off the hook. And he gives up a homer to Brandon Hicks. We go to the home half of the seventh. Stretch time. It's a one-run ball game. series. That gave the Giants a quick 1-0 lead, but the Diamondbacks answer immediately. Bottom one, Paul Goldschmidt against Tim Lincecum. Yes, again, Goldie's first of the year. Made it a 2-1 ball game, and Poseidon out there in the pool liked it. And then, with the game tied up 2-2, Mark Trumbo in the sixth. On the mark, his second as a Diamondback. That made it 4-2. They get one back on the Hicks homer, and it's a 4-3 ball game. This is your Subway in-game box score. Hill 2-for-3, Goldie 2-for-3, Trumbo and Owings 2 hits apiece as well.
Watching Paul Goldschmidt, Mark Trumbo hit those home runs just to the right of straightaway center field. 99% of all baseball players are never going to know what that feels like to have that kind of power to the big part of the ballpark. Most guys have to pull the ball or hit it right down the lines to get it out of the ballpark, but those guys just flip it out.
New pitcher for the Giants, the left-hander David Huff, 29 years old, had an excellent spring. Worked nine innings, gave up one run. Tuffy goes away, pulls it foul down the line. Tuffy getting the start behind the plate this afternoon after the night game last night. Struck out in the second, grounded out in the fifth. Huff jumps ahead 1-2. He was an American leaguer last year. Split last season between the Indians and the Yankees. Worked 14 big league games, went 3-1 with a 5.50 ERA. Picked up by the Giants from the Yankees in a trade in January. Two balls, two strikes to Tuffy Gozawish, who leads off the seventh. It's full. Cliff Pennington is on deck. Pitcher spot is due up. Hop to short, Brandon Crawford. FoxSportsArizona.com, all your online local sports coverage you won't find anywhere else, like Jack McGruder with his analysis from the clubhouse today. Craig Morgan explains how the Coyotes have no margin for error as they prepare for their final five games. And hitting at Chase Field, as we just saw, opening up more opportunities for Mark Trumbo. Good piece on there right now about Trumbo hitting the ball to right field at Chase. All that and more, FoxSportsArizona.com. Huff lost his balance there, his footing. Pennington hits for the pitcher. Cliff got the start last night at shortstop. Struck out twice and reached on an error. Will Harris, who apparently is going to get the eighth inning roll. Showed you David Hernandez in the dugout earlier, recovering from Tommy John surgery. And that left a big void in the Diamondback bullpen. Who would be the eighth inning pitcher? Well, Will Harris worked the eighth on Tuesday night here. And a walk and two strikeouts. Three and one. I tell you what, if anyone says, hey, has anyone in here ever had Tommy John surgery?
They'd all raise their non-throwing arm.
Hudson put up both arms. Matt Reynolds, Patrick Corbin, David Hernandez, Daniel Hudson. Five Tommy John surgeries among the four of them. As Tuffy draws a one-out walk.
Hoping it's not contagious. He's willing to stand right in there.
Pennington's aboard top of the order. Gerardo Parra. Parra 0 for 3, struck out looking his last time up on a pitch that he did not think was a strike, and Pat Hoberg did.
Now, Pat Hoberg's been hearing it a little bit from both dugouts today. Strike zone has been kind of fluid from time to time. Some high pitches have been called strikes. Some pitches down around the bottom of the kneecaps, maybe a little lower, have been called strikes. Off with a pickoff move to first base.
And this is a chance here for Gerardo Parra to improve on the aspect of his game we've talked about, hitting against left-handed pitching. He hit under 200 versus lefties last year.
You don't see very often a left-handed, especially a left-handed reliever, throwing straight changeups to a left-handed hitter. And this is why. That changeup, because of the fading action on it, ends up on the inside part of the plate, sometimes down in the zone, which is generally a happy zone for a left-handed hitter. And Parra just missed extra bases on that changeup. Huff will rely mostly on a two-seam fastball, a cut fastball, a straight changeup, and against the lefties, he'll mix in an occasional over-the-top curveball.
I see right there a 100-point drop in batting average for Parra, righties versus lefties. And the slugging percentage is about a 150-point drop. Shot right there. Beautiful day in downtown Phoenix. A ball and a strike to Parra.
A couple of stolen bases by the D-backs offense with Tim Lincecum on the mound, and all of a sudden Bruce Bochy's going to have his pitcher throw over there a few more times. Stopped by Sanchez. I'll tell you, it's been almost 600 at bats since a D-backs left-handed hitter took a left-handed pitcher deep. Jaime Garcia in St. Louis last year in April. Miguel Montero took him deep to right field.
That was the first series of the season.
That's odd. I mean, I know you don't see as many left-handed pitchers, but it just seems like it's such a an overmatch compared to righties facing righties.
Any idea why that is? Less frequent?
I think that, you know, I've heard that explanation from left-handed hitters. Number one, you don't see a lot of left-handed batting practice to begin with. Some teams carry a righty and a lefty to throw batting practice. Other teams just have right-handed throwers, and that's what you see every day. And then all of a sudden you go out there at 7 o'clock and the guy on the mound's throwing with the other arm, and it's a whole different story for a left-handed hitter. I think it's just, yeah, just the frequency with which you see right-handed pitching, you become a lot more comfortable, and whether you're a righty or a lefty, but the left-handed hitters just never seem real comfortable against left-handed pitching.
And we've talked about that in earlier in the series. When you see a left-handed starter out there, the left-hand hitters often drop down in the batting order.
Or drop all the way over to the bench.
Three balls and two strikes. Cliff Pennington, the runner at first. There he goes. Parra right to Betts. The force on Pennington. Crawford will throw over. But Huff can't get to the bag in time.
Many many times as the game starts, we talk about a pitcher and the stuff he features on the mound. Brandon Crawford threw a pretty nice change up from shortstop to first base that time. David Huff a little slow getting off the mound and getting over there. Got the bat stuck on his hand, couldn't get it off, but Pine Tar, it's a little thicker than he wanted. Huff was slow getting over there, and Brandon Crawford just tried to float a change up over there and lead him to the bag.
3-6 on the put. Worked 1 2/3, had 3 strikeouts, gave up only 1 hit, but the hit was a single to Aaron Hill. And he'll face Aaron Hill in the 7th with 2 outs.
He's really developed into one of Bruce Bochy's go-to guys down there late in the ball game. You see his numbers from last season. He's a strike thrower. He misses bats.
He has not allowed a run in 7 career games at Chase Field. He's worked 7 scoreless innings. And at 32 years old, finds himself on his first ever opening day roster. Good day for Aaron Hill. He has singled twice and scored twice. Gerardo Parra, the runner at first. 2 outs in the 7th. John Machie.
It's a classic example of a really good fastball hitter at the plate in Aaron Hill. He can pull a bullet. John Machie certainly knows that. The Giants know that, so they start him with a couple of off-speed pitches and fall behind the count 2-0. Well, I got news for you. Aaron Hill is still a good fastball hitter, and this is a good fastball count.
That guy's not bad either.
I mean, that's a good approach if you throw one of those first 2 pitches for a strike. But when you miss with both of those off-speed pitches, oh, and he comes back with a nasty sinking 92-mile-an-hour fastball. That was a nasty pitch there. A lot of movement. That's the kind of pitch I'd have to ask the umpire to check the ball. That's not natural.
That pitch, which breaks down and into the right-hand hitter from the right-hand pitcher. Schmidt 2 for 3, a homer and a single. He homered back in the first, his first of the year. There's a strike, 0-1. Ditch school to see Goldie.
It's a good day to do it. Home run back in the first, single in the third. About to do some damage right here, even though he's 0-2.
Another back to the mound. The Chief calls off Sanchez and does a nice play to throw out Goldschmidt. Nice job there. Aaron Hill, his second double this season, his third RBI, and the Diamondbacks tack on a run through seven. They lead it. 5-3-1-0. In the top of the first, really haven't been a problem here as far as we can tell. Will Harris, who was the eighth inning man now that David Hernandez is on the shelf. We saw Will Harris pitch on Tuesday here, work the eighth, and did a very good job. A walk and two strikeouts, struck out Posey and Blanco. And he's facing Pablo Sandoval, Hunter Pence, and Hector Sanchez in the eighth. Sandoval one for three, doubled and scored in the fourth.
We're going to have a brief timeout, something on the warning track in straightaway center field, which is obviously in the line of sight for the hitters. Distractions. He does a little housekeeping, just sticks it in his back pocket.
First he's fighting off bees out there, and now he's cleaning up.
Just a high fastball, 0-2. Yes, he went. Tuffy Gozawish applies the tag. There's the strikeout. Hey, fans, don't forget, now is the time. Tweet us your photo, your fan photo, using the hashtag DBacksFanPhoto for a chance to have your picture shown on an upcoming game broadcast on Fox Sports Arizona. Use the hashtag DBacksFanPhoto, and your fan photo might appear on TV here. It's brought to you by AT&T.
What a good sequence that time from Will Harris. Just absolutely the way you would draw it up to face Pablo Sandoval. Not that there's an easy way to get him out, but jumped ahead in the count, elevated fastball, got him to chase out of the zone, and then a short curveball that bounced in front of home plate. Got the check swing for third strike.
And a quick strike one to Hunter Pence, who's one for three, singled in the fourth. Diamondbacks have done a good job containing Pence in this series. He is one for 15. Because when he hits them, they go. He can hit a ball as hard as anybody.
You know this, partner. Scouts have a term for certain players. He's got a high motor. I'll tell you what, nobody in baseball has a higher motor than Hunter Pence. Man, this guy wakes up in the morning ready to play baseball and goes to bed at night thinking about what he's going to do tomorrow when he gets to the ballpark.
I told you earlier that he was the first Giant since Alvin Dark in 1954 to play all 162 games. And Alvin Dark did that as a New York Giant. That's how long it's been. 3-1. Scatters him in front of the Giant dugout.
Boy, and then certainly there's a value to that. I mean, Hunter Pence does a lot of things well on the field, obviously. But, you know, one of his main attributes is that energy, that high motor. You know, every day when you get to the ballpark, you better plug it in, because if he's in the locker next to you, he's going to be ready to get after it.
Just misses there, and it's ball four, the one-out walk.
That looked like a pretty good pitch right there. Catcher Hoberg strikes him. It's been a little fluid this afternoon from time to time. That cutter is right on the outside corner. Perfect pitch.
That's what Will was thinking. So now the tying runs at the plate. It's Hector Sanchez. Got an RBI sac fly in the fourth. Giants get the run back. Brandon McCarthy was bristling about a non-called strike three earlier in this series, and now Will Harris can make the same case.
Shortstop Brandon Crawford.
Pitch letter high out over the plate for Sanchez. Gets good extension. Fortunately for the D-backs, had a lot of topspin on that line drive. Kept it in the ballpark. But Pence motoring around from first base after that walk. Was able to score the tying run. Actually, a run closer. Excuse me.
So Sanchez comes out of the game. Juan Perez will run in his place. He's the tying run in scoring position with one out. And Brandon Crawford is the hitter. Crawford is 0 for 1. He's walked twice. There's a strike. The entire left side of the field is now covered in shadow. Even A.J. Pollock in center field is now standing in the dark. Can't see A.J., but he's at the top of your picture there.
It looks like a scene from Independence Day.
It does. There's a big spaceship coming in overhead. Still a bright sun for Parra in right, the 0-2.
Yeah, the good news, at least for the hitters, is... home plate's in the sunshine, the mound's in the sunshine, and has been all afternoon.
Oh, work!
Off the fist, very shallow center. A.J. Pollock is there. Big out for Will Harris, two down.
Sanchez coming out of the game for a pinch runner. Buster Posey's going to have to come into the ball game as a defender, so why not pick a spot to get his bat in there? He's going to hit right here for Adrianza.
Pinch hitting for Ray Adrianza, number 28, Buster Posey.
Posey last night was 2 for 4, a pair of singles. Mike Harkey to the mound. Of course, he had that big home run in the ninth inning against Addison Reed in the series opener Monday.
Oh, his
infield.
For the pitcher spot. A review of the scouting report, obviously, but probably more so a discussion. What do you want to do here? Go after Buster Posey. If we fall behind, we'll go ahead and walk him with first base open. If we jump ahead, we're going to try to expand the strike zone, get him to chase something. If we lose him then, we'll go after Michael Morse, who's much more of a free swinger, has bigger holes in his swing than Buster Posey.
Yeah, Buster Posey's certainly a much tougher out than Michael Morse. Juan Perez, the pinch runner at second base. He's the tying run with two outs. First base open. We see how they work to Posey. First pitch misses. It's 1-0.
I would guess you're going to see four cutters either on or off of the outside corner. No reason to even challenge him inside for any reason.
Another one, 2-0.
The problem with a guy like Posey is he has such a good eye for the strike zone. He knows the situation. He knows what he would do as a catcher in this situation. And now in the 2-0 count, they're not going to waste any more time. Go ahead and put him on. To the chagrin of some of the Giants fans here at the ballpark today.
And they'll take their chances with big Michael Morse. I don't think there's any question this is the right move.
Oh, man.
Second walk in the inning by Harris. That's intentional. And here comes Morse.
John Machi, number 38, Michael Morse.
One thing about resting your regulars day game after a night game gives you a pretty good bench.
Mm-hmm.
And Bruce Bochy is taking advantage. Ball one. Harris behind 2-0. Gotta be careful with Morse. Got big power there.
Usually a fastball count, a real good fastball hitter up at the plate, and Will Harris drops in an absolutely perfect strike curveball. That'll make you start thinking as a hitter. Oh, geez.
For second and throw in the center. They wave Perez. He scores and the game is tied.
Tried to come right back with that same curveball. That time Morse with a defensive swing just fights it off back up the middle of the field. But with Chris Owings cheating over toward the hole between third and short, there was a big gap up the middle of the field, and Morse took advantage.
Well, it is the anniversary of the longest game in Chase Field history, 5 hours and 32 minutes, which, by the way, was also on getaway day. That one's against the Cardinals. It's a day game, Bob, so we got lots of time. Angel Pagan in the pool. And the Giants have scored 5 in the 8th. That's Pagan's 3rd hit today.
A happy zone for most left-handed hitters. Certainly for Angel Pagan it is. Deposits out and out of the pool.
Kirk Gibson to the mound. That's it for Will Harris. Giants have come up with 5 runs in the 8th. They lead it 8-5. New pitcher for the D-backs. We saw him last night for the first time in the big league since 2010, the Hyphenator. The left-hander from New South Wales, Australia, Ryan Roland Smith.
And once again, back-to-back left-handed hitters, followed by the switch-hitting Pablo Sandoval. So this is when you go to your lefty.
Blanco walked his last time up. Ryan worked an inning last night, gave up a hit, a walk, had a strikeout, threw 23 pitches. In his first big league appearance since 2010 when he was with the Seattle Mariners. And he has worked his way back here as a lefty specialist. Popped him up, shallow left, Mark Trumbo. Five run Giants 8th has changed things a bit here. CenturyLink, your link to watch next. Coming up though, Mark Trumbo. Colombo, who homered his last time up. That to 3-1-8-2-6. You can visit dbacks.com for details. Santiago Casilla, the new pitcher for the Giants. Martin Prado leads off the Arizona eighth. Saw Casilla in the second game of this series. He worked one inning, had a strikeout. Buster Posey came in as a pinch hitter. He remains in the game, takes over behind the plate. Joaquin Arias is the new second baseman, and Juan Perez, who was the pinch runner for Hector Sanchez, moves out to play left field.
And with Arias coming into the ballgame at second base defensively, Bruce Bochy has exhausted his bench. No position players left.
Prado 3-for-24 to start the year. Sandoval.
Sandoval, we've talked about throughout this series, losing the weight that he did. He just looks so much more mobile, so much more athletic. His legs are underneath him this year. I mean, he's always going to be a thick guy. He's just built that way. But he was carrying an extra 25 pounds the last couple of years. He looks so much better defensively and offensively this year.
Well, he said this winter that he put it in his mind he needed to grow up and take the job seriously. Mark Trumbo looks at ball one. Trumbo launched a long home run his last time up, doubled in the first. We were talking about Bob how Bruce Bochy has exhausted his bench. Sandoval's weight loss plays into that, because he would often have to come out of games last year when he was heavy. He was replaced last season 41 times in 137 starts, which was more than twice as much compared to 2009, which was his rookie year.
And those little nagging injuries that every player gets over the course of the season. You can see light on his feet as the ball got into the hitting zone, and both feet coming back down to the ground, ready to react whichever direction he needed to. Yeah, but those little nagging injuries, you foul a ball off your foot, you get hit by a pitch, or whatever the case may be, and those injuries tend to hang on a little bit longer when you're carrying that extra weight and pounding on that injury.
Mark Trumbo had already tossed his bat back toward the dugout before Pat Hoberg signaled strike.
Up there at the top of the zone.
Sandoval weight loss, just to finish up, in a sense, if you don't have to worry about yanking him out of the game late all the time, it in one sense gives you an extra bench play, or at least more flexibility certainly.
Well, they may not have that situation at third base this year, but it looks like they're going to have it in left field with Michael Morse. Every time the Giants have had a lead late and Morse has been the starting left fielder, they make that change usually after his third at bat. If they have a lead in the game, bring in a defender to play left field.
Well, Mark Trumbo would like to have a discussion with Pat Hoberg about that at bat. Oof, that's a good pitch.
Tailing action on that fastball brought it right back to the corner.
Two down, Chris Owings, 2-for-3. He singled his last two times up. He's got 8 hits in his first 17 at bats this season. After hitting 330 in the Pacific Coast League last year for the Reno Aces, and he was league MVP.
don't know how Bruce Bochy feels about this, but I never really liked to bring in my starting catcher if I was trying to give him a day off. Now, as it worked out, Boach used his bench perfectly. The guys that he brought into the game did what he wanted them to do, but now you're forced to bring Buster Posey into the game behind the plate. Hasn't really had the chance to go through his normal pregame prep. I'm sure as he realized he was going to be in this game, he possibly went up the tunnel to the batting cage, did some stretching, probably did a little bit of throwing, got his legs loose, but it's not quite the same. When you're used to starting those ball games, you've got a very definitive plan of how you're going to get ready for the game. When you come off that bench, sometimes it's, hey, get your gear on, you're catching next inning.
He makes a strong, accurate throw almost every time. So a busy inning there for the Panda at third as we go to the ninth here. And the Diamondbacks trail the Giants 8-5.
And as well as microfracture surgery. So on the upside, they've got a lot of guys they can talk to about the journey back after a surgery like that. But nice to have David back with the club. And obviously disappointed, but excited to get back to rehab, which starts in about 4 or 5 weeks.
Yeah, Brad, that was especially disappointing considering how hard David had worked in the offseason. Bob, he looked terrific. He looked like a different guy physically. He lost so much weight. He was in great shape, throwing the ball well, and then just out of nowhere got hit with another Tommy John bug on the Diamondbacks.
Boy, and Brad brought up a great point. You wish nobody ever had to go through that, but because the Diamondbacks have had so many pitchers who have done it and come back from it, hopefully they can smooth some of that rehab process, avoid some of the speed bumps that maybe they went through in their rehab, and make it a little bit easier for David.
Ryan Rowland-Smith back out there to start the ninth against the lefty Brandon Belt. Brad Ziegler warming. You've got a switch hitter up next in Pablo Sandoval, then the right hand hitting Hunter Pence.
Breaking ball just never took the break that time. Tuffy had slid out on that outside corner and low, hoping to get Belt to chase a breaking ball out of the zone. It just never took the break. It's kind of spun up and in. Backup breaking ball.
Called strike three.
Backup breaking ball. If you were a pitching coach and could figure out a way to teach a guy to do that consistently, you'd be the highest paid pitching coach in the history of the sport. That was right down the pipe that time. Four seam fastball, see you later. Yeah, a hitter recognizes the rotation on the ball, and based on that, you anticipate where the pitch is going to end up when it gets into the hitting zone. So you see breaking ball spin. You anticipate where that ball is going to be when it gets to home plate, and it doesn't go the direction you expect it to. Very effective pitch, but completely by accident.
Ryan Rowland-Smith, the impressive numbers pitching for Triple-A Pawtucket in the Red Sox system last year. Panda doubled and scored back in the fourth. As he works his way back into the big leagues, was a starter for most of his career. 20 starts in 2010 with the Mariners, went 1-10. His ERA was over 7. And then he kind of wandered the wilderness for a while. Eventually landed after stints with the Astros and the Cubs in the Red Sox system. And had a very good year in AAA last year before he needed an appendectomy that finished off his season.
I mentioned a couple innings ago that the batters had had a break because the shadows hadn't really been a factor, but definitely are now.
A Funny, the right-hand box is in shadow. The left-hand box is in the sun. Two-hopper to Prado at third. Two up, two down.
Right fielder, Hunter Pence.
Hunter Pence coming up. Kirk Gibson to the mound. Good job by Ryan Rowland-Smith, who got his two hitters. And now Brad Ziegler will come in to try and finish off the ninth. We're back after this. It's tough enough facing Brad Ziegler, but here you can't even see him. His third appearance this year. It'll be Hunter Pence bobblehead day when we're in San Francisco next week. He started the practice of riding one of those little scooters to the ballpark when he was acquired by the Giants. Lived in the area near the ballpark and would take the scooter in to work every day. So the bobblehead is Hunter Pence on a scooter. Owens at short. 1-2-3 ninth by the D-backs bullpen. Bottom nine coming up. Diamondbacks trail the Giants 8-5. Ninth inning, A.J. Pollock leads it off against Santiago Casilla. A.J. Pollock, Tuffy goes to wish, and the pitcher spot due up in the ninth, down 8-5. Another rough afternoon for the D-backs bullpen.
Get somebody on there and see what happens. That's the only attitude you can have. Trailing by three in the bottom of the ninth. Just hope to get that leadoff man on base. Put some pressure on the defense. Roll around to that top of the order. Make something happen.
Expect Eric Chavez to hit for the pitcher. And indeed, Xavi has a helmet on and bat in hand in the dugout. Just got to get some base runners on ahead of him here.
Yeah, and you mentioned Eric Chavez with a helmet on in the dugout. Miguel Montero also available, and certainly Bruce Bochy's aware of that. He's got his left-hander Javier Lopez throwing in the bullpen right now.
Broke his bat in half. That was ugly. Oof. He huffed the handle and was actually sticking in the ground in the dirt.
I'm not sure if that was by accident or if A.J. in frustration just spiked it down into the baseline right there. But
there it is.
You can see clearly how that bat split lengthwise.
Oof.
Just above his hands all the way out past the barrel.
Now if he goes away show for three. Two down. Second strikeout for Casilla, both looking. Bruce Bochy waiting for Chavez to be announced. So it's up to Chuck Drago here. Chuck Drago stalling for time. Our PA announcer.
Pinch hit for Brad Sigler, number 12, Eric Chavez.
Now Chavez is official, so Bochy will continue his trip to the mound and go get Casilla and bring in his lefty Lopez. Coming back after this. The left-hander Javier Lopez brought on to face pinch hitter Eric Chavez. Parra on deck if Chavez should reach. Diamondbacks led it 5-3 after 7. Giants answered with a 5-run eighth. Sergio Romo already with 2 saves in the series standing by. Brandon Belt. And what's the ball game? Diamondbacks dropped 3 of 4 in a series they could have easily have won 3 of 4. They led the opener on Monday 7-3 after 6, lost that ball game 9-8. They led here today 5-3. And they lose it 8-5.
Yeah, not exactly the way you hope to start your home part of the schedule, but a lot of baseball left to play. Bullpen needs to tighten it up just a little bit. I got to tell you, I'm impressed with the way the offense has swung the bats. The way the Cactus League ended, it looked like they were sputtering a little bit, but a number of guys have gotten it going here in the early going. Just got to find a way to keep the other team off the board late.
Yeah, the starting pitching has been very solid with the exception of last night when Tim Hudson was outstanding. The offense has been there, but late innings. The relief corps has had some hiccups, and now the Diamondbacks drop to 1-5 as the Giants come to Chase Field and take 3 games of this 4-game set. Diamondbacks will get on a plane